The trip back home actually is my favorite of my picture books, not because I think it's the best written, but because I really believe in the message. And we're not supposed to you know, transmit messages and be preachy, but I do think that some of the best gifts are not the not the store-bought gifts, but the well-chosen, inexpensive gifts, the things that we really think about, what do they need? And also the handmade, homemade gifts. And so that's really the message in this book. Can I read a little? Okay. The week we went on the trip back home to visit the village where Mother grew up, we shopped for gifts for our family, things we thought they would need. I'll skip a few pages ahead. We gave my grandfather, my Haraboji, a pair of leather work gloves, tough and tanned, like his thick-skinned farmer's hands. We gave my grandmother, my Halmoni, an apron ruffled at the edge, with two large pockets in the shape of flowers. We gave my aunt, my Imo, a picture book with simple words to teach her English. Well, we gave them all these store-bought gifts, but when the day came for us to make our trip back home, Haraboji gave us a charcoal drawing of the hills behind the house, and Halmoni gave us dried persimmons strung together in a necklace, and Imo gave us a poem in Korean, folded small, and we gave them hugs. So, you know, kids feel such pressure to save money, to make money, to buy things, to buy a good Mother's Day present, to buy a good birthday present, a good Christmas present. I want kids to think, you know, maybe the best present might be a poem folded small. Maybe the best present might be a charcoal drawing or some jam that you make out of blueberries that you pick during the summer. It doesn't have to be expensive. It could be something that you really think about. You know, I've noticed that her apron is a little bit tattered. Maybe she would like a new apron. She loves flowers. Maybe she would like an apron with flowers. It doesn't have to be fancy. So that's the message in this book. Something that not everyone knows is that I used to hate poetry. Actually, in fourth grade, I really hated poetry, and I don't think it was because I knew poetry. I think it was because I hated having to memorize poems. I have a terrible memory. I hated having to memorize poems. I also hated having to read poems and pick them apart, analyze them, try to find the right answer. That really, really bothered me. And so I thought I hated poetry. But I think what I hated was poetry homework. That's what I hated. And anyway, so when I quit my law job to write, it never occurred to me to write poetry. The thought never even occurred to me. And if someone had asked me, do you think you're going to write poetry? I would have said, no, I don't think so. Definitely not. But one day I was at a seminar, a Saturday seminar, Everything You Need to Know to Write and Sell Your Children's Book. And I was there not to learn how to write. I thought I knew how to write. I was there to learn how to sell. I was there to listen to the editor speak at the end of the day about how she chose books to publish. So I was just sitting through and, you know, just not really paying attention to the speakers. And Myra Cohn Livingston got up to speak. I had no idea who she was. Myra Cohn Livingston. The name meant nothing to me. She got up. She said she was the author of over 80 books of poetry. And I thought, oh, poetry. So I started doodling, looking out the window, not paying attention. And then Myra read a poem of hers called There Was a Place from a book by the same name, There Was a Place. It's now out of print, but you can find it in a library. She read the poem and I started blinking back tears. And I was thinking about my grandmother and how she looked in her hospital bed when she was dying. And I thought, oh my goodness, if that little poem can make me feel so much inside, there's something I can learn from that woman. But it wasn't until 26 rejection letters later that I decided I did need to learn how to write, that maybe writing for children was a different skill than what I knew how to do, and that maybe if I learned about rhyme and repetition and rhythm, those poetic devices, then maybe I could write a picture book that would sell. I think one way that poetry can be shared with kids, one easy way, one fun way, is with a poetry suitcase. And this requires no work on your part. You tell your students, or the classroom decides that they're going to build a poetry suitcase, okay? And everyone in the class has a responsibility to bring in one poem, written on an index card maybe, because when you write it, it gets into your system, much the same way that memorizing a poem gets into your system. So maybe everyone in the classroom has the responsibility to bring in one poem written on an index card. And if that poem is about trees, tie that poem to a branch. If that poem is about rocks, tie that poem to a rock. If that poem is about dogs, maybe you'll tie that poem to a biscuit, to a dog bone, okay? And then at the end of the week, or however long you decide to take to do this, everyone will bring a poem and something tied to it and put it in a suitcase. You'll have a poetry suitcase. And then, 5 minutes a day. 5 minutes a day when everyone's got their backpacks on and you're ready to go, but there you are, stuck with each other. Someone can pick something out of the suitcase. Someone who's been really good that day can pick something out of the suitcase. Maybe a certain boy will be really curious about what that cookie cutter goes to, and we'll pick the cookie cutter out of the suitcase, and it'll be tied to a poem. Maybe it'll be tied to my poem, Grandmother's Almond Cookies in a Suitcase of Seaweed. Or someone else might be really curious, I wonder what that snake belongs to. And we'll pull out a rubber snake, and maybe that poem will be tied to my poem, In the Rainbow Hand, called In Mother's Shadow, where I say, she sees snakes before they move. You never know. It'll be a mystery. What does this thing go to? And that's an easy way to share poems. You could do it for 5 minutes a day. You could do it for 1 minute a day. And the bell will ring and everyone will leave happy with poems bouncing around in their minds.
For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.